The National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated stations present The Pacific Story. This is the story of the Pacific, the drama of the millions of people who live around this greatest sea, where the United States is now committed to a long-term policy of keeping the peace. This is a documentary account of the situation in the Pacific, of the men and events which are today influencing world affairs for generations to come. The Fiji Islands.
I say, is your name Camely?
Yes.
Blake is my name. This is Dr. Cowdery.
How do you do? Are you a doctor? A real doctor?
Yes.
You have just come to Fiji?
Oh, it's been a few weeks now.
Good, good. You at the medical school in Suva?
Yes.
Dr. Cowdery was good enough to come up here to Lao Toka with me to help me find a guide.
Guide?
Yes. You know that gold has been discovered up near Tavor?
Yes.
Well, I'd like to hire you to guide me up into the gold field.
Me?
Yes. The people here in Lao Toka say you know that country around Tavor.
Well, yes.
Well, a great deal of gold has been taken out up there, and it would mean some money to you.
No. I don't think so.
You're not interested in the gold?
Oh, gold is good, maybe.
Well, about all we'll have to do if we get up into the gold country is stake out a claim. Can't be so very far from here.
No. I have plenty of bananas and coconuts. Plenty of maize and rice and sugar cane.
Cowdery, does he mean it?
Well, I think he does.
Look, Camely. All you're doing here is sitting outside your house singing to yourself. If you go up to Tavua with me, you'll get much gold.
No. I stay here. Since Jesus came into my heart.
I can't believe it, Cowdery.
You might as well try to get somebody else.
Yes, I guess you're right. Well, come on, let's go.
Yes.
Are you going back to the medical school in Suva, Dr. Cowdery?
As soon as I get Mr. Blake's here fixed up, yes.
Good. Since Jesus came into my heart.
A couple of days later, we found a guide for Blake, and they went up into the gold country. I returned to Suva. I thought about Camely, tall, muscular, a superior physical type. And I talked about him with Dr. Weldon.
They're remarkable people, the Fijians.
You know, I've never seen such a happy people.
Well, they've got everything. And if they had their way, they'd laugh and live and sing songs.
I had come to the Fiji Islands to help train Fijians to be what we called NMPs, Native Medical Practitioners. There were few white doctors in the islands, and there was need for medical help to treat the 500,000 people of the islands.
The Fijians are a healthy people, Cowdery, as you've seen.
Yes, I've noticed.
They're a mixture of the black Melanesian and the lighter Polynesian. That's why they have high intelligence along with their superstitions and their savagery.
You know, you hardly realize that they can be savage.
Well, actually, Cowdery, some of the grandparents or great-grandparents of the people we're working with here at school were cannibals.
Well, then they've made enormous strides in the space of a few generations.
Yes, they have.
A lot of credit for that must go to the missionaries.
Well, yes. Nearly every native is a Christian. That's why many of them are always singing hymns.
Oh, that explains it.
But, as you know, when the white man brought in Christianity, he also brought in disease. Hysteria, tuberculosis, measles, even leprosy.
Yes. I know that, Dr. Weldon.
They had, of course, their own diseases. Blackwater fever and other things. So although the people here are fairly healthy, at the same time, they're plagued not only with their own diseases, but also with ours. And that's why our work here training NMPs is so important.
The Fijians who came to the medical school were alert, quick, eager. Everything they did showed their intelligence. For admission, all they had to have was the equivalent of a good high school education. The NMP course was 4 years of anatomy and surgery.
There is a letter for you, Dr. Cowdery.
Letter? Thank you. Oh, it's from Blake. Dear Hal, I've been up here around Tavua now for 6 months, and the amount
of gold being taken out up here is fabulous. I'd make a horseback guess that something like $5 million worth of gold will be taken out this year. Of course, my part of that is going to be comparatively small. But I'm getting squared around now for a bigger operation. Things are going along fairly smoothly. There's a little trouble here, as you would expect.
But I'm going to get out with some kind of a stake. Whatever you are. I used to go down to the beach there in Suva and look out over the Pacific. New Zealand, more than 1,000 miles to the south. Australia, more than 1,500 miles to the southeast. Samoa, 500 miles to the northeast. I used to look out over the fine harbor at Suva, big enough to hold a battle fleet. Between the barrier reef, coral, and the shore, many ships riding at anchor.
Vitalevu here is the largest of all the Fiji Islands, Dr. Cowdery.
I used to talk with one of the NMP students.
I was born up in Sigatoka.
He was as proud of his hometown as any youth in the United States is of his.
But I always wanted to come down here to the capital at Suva. Do you like it here, Dr. Cowdery?
Well, yes, I like it here. It's a different world for me, though.
A different world, yes.
In the months to come, I travel to most of the 80 Fiji islands that are inhabited, to Vanua Levu and to Kandavu and to all the others. On my way back, I stopped off in the Tuvua gold country to see Blake.
Mr. Blake is gone.
How long has he been gone?
Long time now.
Where did he go?
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows?
No.
Why did he leave?
Trouble, maybe.
Oh. Well, what of his claim? Is it shut down?
No, still working.
That's about all I ever found out about Blake. This was my first personal brush with the dark side of the Fijians. It was my first index of the side of the Fijians about which I knew so little, and I was to learn so much. I headed back for Suva. Going through Lautoka, I heard a familiar voice and a familiar song. It was Kamali. I went up to him.
Yes. I remember you. You are the doctor.
That's right.
When I finish my work in school, I want to come to Suva.
Well, Suva's an important city. Biggest city in the island.
Oh, it's not for that. I want to go to your school and become a native medical practitioner.
You do?
Yes, it's what I want to do. My mother died from the fever. My brother's sick with the yaws. His skin is very bad now.
How much longer must you go to school?
2 years. Then I'm coming to Suva.
Well, keep in touch with me, Kennelly.
So thank you. Yes, I will.
I looked him over from head to foot as he talked. A magnificent specimen. Tall, powerful. Dark skin, crisp hair, deep-set eyes. A modern man, only a few generations removed from savagery. Yet interested in the humanitarian. Eager to devote his life to helping others. Back at the medical school, I plunged into the work with renewed vigor.
We are going to add a pathological laboratory and a bacteriological laboratory, Cowdery.
That's excellent.
It'll mean a great deal out here. And the Fijians are ready for this kind of work.
Excuse me, please. But this word has just come.
Yes. Listen to this, Cowdrey. The situation in Europe has been complicated by the intervention of foreign nations in the Spanish Civil War. Germany and Italy are aiding the Falangists, and Russia is aiding the Loyalists. So far, Britain has not become embroiled.
If Britain becomes involved, then we are involved.
Well, yes.
Are we going to get into war?
Probably not now, but it's coming.
From this time on, when I stood on the beach and looked out over the seas, I knew that the sea could never keep war from affecting us. From this time on, we watched closely the trend of events in Europe and the growing tension in the Pacific. I came to understand more clearly how the Fijis were tied to the outside world.
You see, until now, we've exported just about all our sugar to New Zealand. Now, we're shipping more and more of it to Canada.
This was a planter.
But rising sugarcane's hard work, and the Fijians have no necessity to work hard.
It was the same old story.
So we've got to bring in Indian coolie labor.
But the Fijians are good agriculturalists, aren't
they? Yes, excellent, but they don't care about working in the sugar plantations. That is, as hard as the Indians do.
Then the Indians are stiff competitors for the Fijians.
Yes, the Indians are hard-working and they're thrifty. And after they worked a while in the sugar plantations and saved up enough money, they leave the plantations and raise rice and cotton, even goats for themselves. But what's worrying the authorities is that the Indians are beginning to have political ambitions. You know, there are almost as many Indians here in the Fijis as there are Fijians.
But difficult as this situation was within the Fijis, it was overshadowed by the momentous events outside the islands.
The Japanese had attacked the Chinese outside Beijing.
They had?
Yes. It started in the Pacific, Cowdrey.
Well, it's still a good many thousand miles from us here.
It may as well be on our doorstep. It's only a matter of time until it's here.
Come to Suva.
Yes, I've come to go to school.
You're serious about becoming a practitioner?
Yes, I'm here ready to start. Here are my papers.
Oh, fine. Well, come along. Let's see what we can do about it. Camille showed an extraordinary aptitude for medicine. Sometimes as I watched him vaccinating or giving hypodermics, I marveled. Fingers as deft as those of a violinist. Gentle. Sensitive. A jolly sense of humor, music brimming and bubbling out like water. And yet with a side that was tied to 1,000 and 10,000 years of darkness.
Dr. Cowdrey. Witch doctors cannot be right, can they?
Of course not, Camille.
Of course they cannot. It is ridiculous.
Quinine will do more for a person with malaria than any witch doctor.
I know. They have a strong influence, though, Dr. Cowdrey.
We could teach him and the other Fijians how to treat the sick, but this part of them we could never touch. We train them how to fight infection, the importance of cleanliness, how to reduce fractures, how to deliver babies. One dark night, when we were on duty together, one of the boys brought a message.
Britain has declared war on Germany.
It has come.
The Germans are marching into Poland, and France and Britain have both declared war on Germany.
We will have to go to war now, Dr. Cowdrey.
Yes, if Britain's in the war, then we're in the war.
Will we have to fight?
Yes, I think we will.
We kept tab on the progress of the war in Europe. We shuddered with England through the terrible months of 1940, through Dunkirk and the Blitz and the desperate days that had followed.
A contingent of New Zealand troops are going to land here at Suva tomorrow, Cowdrey.
I've been expecting some such move.
All seven seas are now a battlefield between us and the enemy.
Yes.
Let us hope that we do not also have to fight Japan.
Yes. The next day, Camille went with me down to the waterfront.
Ah, they're a fine-looking group. Some of New Zealand's best. They're wonderful.
Yes,
wonderful.
I knew from the way Camille regarded those New Zealand troops that he would volunteer the first chance he got. Immediately, when Fiji volunteers were asked for, he came to me.
I want to join, Dr. Culver.
Oh, you're only halfway through your NMP corps.
I want to join.
You mean in the medical corps?
No, I just want to be a soldier. I can finish my work in medicine later.
Fijians came from every one of the 80 inhabited islands. Strong, intelligent men. I watched them train through the months of 1940 and 41. Became the officers of the Fiji Infantry Battalion. They and the Fijians in battle dress were something to see.
Japan is at war with the United States and Britain. The Japanese are delivering powerful blows against both British and American positions in the Pacific.
It's here, Cousin. It's here.
I've been hoping all along that it would not come. But all the time, I knew it would.
The Fijis have now assumed new importance. Strategic importance. We are the outpost for the defense of New Zealand and Australia.
Do you think the Japanese will get as far as this?
Well, Britain is crippled in the Pacific. The U.S. is crippled. The Japanese are already driving down Malaya into the Indies and eastward toward us. If they take our islands here, they'll be able to cut off supplies from reaching Australia and New Zealand from the U.S. without a long roundabout detour.
If the Fijis fell, the American base 500 miles to the northeast in Samoa would be in danger and might be cut off from reinforcements and supplies. We worked like mad. Reinforcements were coming, but we knew it was a race with the Japanese. Then, early one morning, I was awakened. In the harbor were American ships, transports, and men of war. Troops, New Zealand troops, Fijian troops. In no time, the Americans were picking up Fijian words.
Hiya, boy. Bula. Bula.
He said Bula.
They learned fast, Kamala. Bula means hello.
Bula, boy. Bula.
Bula, Bula. Sambula Vanaka.
What was that last?
Sambula Vanaka.
That means, God bless you.
Oh. Sambula Vanaka, kid. Sambula Vanaka.
What is that word they say, kid? What does that mean, kid?
Kamele was trained for commando operations. And when his outfit moved out, I went with them. The Americans had taken Guadalcanal. We landed there and then moved across the channel to Cape Torokino, Empress Augusta Bay, and Bougainville.
There are something like 50,000 Japanese deployed on this island. They're short of rations. Our mission is to find out first how long their rations will last, and second, what the Japanese commander is up to. The honor to carry out this dangerous mission has fallen to us, the 1st Battalion of the Fiji Infantry Regiment. You've been trained for jungle combat, and with your own natural skill, you should be more than a match for the Japanese. We will move out into the enemy country and establish an outpost at Ibu on the other side of the island, 10 miles from the strong Japanese position at Numa Numa. Any questions?
The transformation in the Fiji troops as they moved out into the enemy-held country was amazing. Covered with ferns and brush, they became part of the jungle. But more than that, they slipped into the jungle with an eagerness, a sense of sureness, with a certain restrained delight that told me they were, indeed, only a few generations removed from their cannibal ancestors. Their skill and their deadliness in jungle operations did not fully impress me until later, when we received word by radio that they had penetrated the Japanese lines and had established their stronghold in the jungle in the Japanese rear at Ibu.
Dr. Cowdery, I want you to go with me by air to Ibu.
There were just three of us. Almost the instant we took off at Cape Torokino, we were over enemy territory.
Thick jungle below us there, Doctor.
Yes.
And it's filled with Japanese. We'll be over Ibu in about 15 minutes.
Have you seen the new landing strip there, pilot?
Yes, sir. Very small.
They hewed it out in remarkably short time.
Yes, sir.
My first glimpse of the landing strip frightened me. It looked like little more than a path.
Hold on. We're going in for a landing.
The strip was not much more than 300 feet long. The end of it fell off into a canyon. The jungle stood like a wall at the edge of the landing strip. Tangled vines, palms, ferns, and a profusion of underbrush that was stifling. As soon as I heard that, I knew Camille was near.
Bula, Dr. Cuddy.
Camille, I hardly knew you.
The cause of this coach spilt?
Yes.
It's from parachutes.
Camille and the other Fijian troops decked themselves in the colored silks. And as I stood there looking at them, I had a fleeting feeling of satisfaction that these men were on our side. I went with them to raid Pipi Paia.
We should be within sight of Numa Numa now.
A young New Zealander was in command.
Watch now. Watch as we come over the top of this ridge. Move up.
I looked back at Camille, creeping through the jungle as if he were part of it. He smiled at me and tapped the pocket on his chest. In that pocket was his testament. He had complete faith and no fear. The Fijians have remarkable eyesight and an incredible jungle sense.
There is Numa Numa.
It took me a minute to spot it, almost hidden in the jungle.
That's it, all right. Easy. We're getting close to the sentries. Move up.
Camille and the other Fijians moved through the jungle almost without making a sound. I crept as quietly as I could.
There is a Japanese.
It's a sentry. Down, down. All right. Move up.
My heart pounded as we slipped by him.
There is a clearing.
That's Pipi Paia, all right. Ready now.
Suddenly, the signal was given. Camille was upon the sentry like a tiger. And suddenly, the entire jungle was alive. Japanese troops swarmed into the clearing. Not one Fijian was hit. Pipi Paia clearing was strewn with Japanese dead.
We caught them, Dr. Calder.
Yes, Camille. I hope we shall be as lucky every time.
We will.
After this, the Fijians infiltrated the Japanese lines almost at will. No Japanese, alone or in patrol, escaped alive if he came across them. They even penetrated the Japanese perimeter of Numa Numa and brought back information on the enemy installations, the kinds of weapons they were using, and the number and distribution of their troops. And what was, in a way, more important, on their food situation.
They have taken all the food from the native gardens, and they're now living on emergency rations.
Good. They cannot be evacuated from the island because our aircraft are sinking every Japanese ship that comes near. And if they're that short on rations, we have inactivated their entire force on Bougainville.
Then came a report and an order from our headquarters at Cape Torokino.
The Japanese are massing powerful forces here around Empress Augusta Bay. Also, they are moving down the east coast to Numa Numa with a view to taking Ibu. Therefore, destroy and evacuate Ibu at once.
Our mission at Ibu was completed.
We must leave here, but we cannot return to Cape Torokino. We are cut off there. Your work here has been magnificent, and on the basis of your reconnaissance, we know now that we can leave the Japanese here to die on the vine. The remaining question is whether we can get out alive. Set fire to everything. We will evacuate at once.
Except for the old mission house, we left nothing to the Japanese but ruin.
Dr. Calder.
Yes, Camille.
I am one of five to be left behind here as rear guard to cover the retreat of the company.
Oh, Camille.
Just five of you?
Yes. The Japanese are expected before dark.
I think I will stay with you, Kemmerly.
No, Dr. Cosner.
Maybe I can help.
No. You are needed. Back in Suva.
I got permission to stay. We took up positions in the ruins of some huts. Kemmerly and another Fijian and I were in one hut. The three others were in another hut, situated so that we could catch the oncoming enemy in our crossfire. We waited. Just before dark, the Japanese began to sift into the ruins of Ibu.
Those in the other hut have opened fire on them.
Yes.
They are advancing on the other hut.
Yes, wait. Do not shoot yet. Wait.
Now.
Look! We scattered them. We stopped them.
Now we must watch out.
We're ready for them.
He is hit, Dr. Cowden.
I'll take care of him.
Yes, I will hold them off. Kemmerly was shot through the neck. I gave him first aid in the gathering darkness. He smiled and tapped his breast pocket with a testament in it. I took it out and placed it in his hand. I kept my fingers on his pulse and felt his life ebbing away. And there in the darkness, in that burned-out hut in the jungle, Kemmerly died. Kemmerly there. The other young Fijian and I slipped out in the night and at last joined the rest of the Fiji company. And now I'm back again in Suva, back in the Central Medical School. A new class of Fijians is in training to become NMPs. When I look at them, I think of Kemmerly. And then I know my place is here among the people that he wanted to serve.
Been listening to The Pacific Story, presented by the National Broadcasting Company and its affiliated independent stations to clarify events in the Pacific and to make understandable the cross currents of life in the Pacific Basin. For a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. To repeat, for a reprint of this Pacific Story program, send 10 cents in stamps or coin to University of California Press, Berkeley, California. Pacific Story is written and produced by Arnold Marquis. The music was scored by Henry Russell. The principal voice was that of Herman Waldman. And now, Gain Whitman has something of importance to say to you. Gain?
The future catches up with us very quickly. Do you have today what you thought you'd have several years ago? To protect your future, buy United States saving bonds now. Buy them regularly, every payday. And if you are already doing that, buy extra bonds now. These are difficult times for all of us. The one way to be sure of a better tomorrow is to provide for it today. Buy U.S. saving bonds now.
Programs in this series of particular interest to servicemen and women are broadcast overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This program came to you from Hollywood and is heard in Canada over the facilities of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.